Imagine a world where relighting pictures doesn't mean changing the colors. But why imagine it when it's here?
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Stable Diffusion for Professional Creatives. Today, we will take a look at how we can solve color matching and preserving details when relighting people. Now, those of you who know me from the past videos already know that this has been a crux of my work, and I've been trying hard to get it working. And, well, it looks like we finally did it. This is the workflow that we are going to be looking at today. You can find the workflow in the description below, as well as any other custom nodes or models you might need for this to work. Any of you who had tried IC light know that relighting pictures usually comes with a high cost, and that's that the relighting changes the color of the overall picture. Some of us obviously don't want that, and while most of you don't want that, you've made that perfectly clear. And so when we are starting out from a picture such as this one on the top left corner and end up with a picture such as this one on the right, we are not happy. And that's why I embarked on the quest of actually finding a way to preserve color and details when relighting photos. And while we had already solved product relighting in the past videos, people relighting was being a totally different beast. With people, you want to have the overall mood and feel remain the same. You just want to change the light. Now, starting from the top here, we have four different ways of relighting while preserving details and color matching. The first one is a very simple one, and it's a very bad one at that. It's there just to showcase the limitations of color matching to very different images without doing anything else. We'll talk about those limitations in a bit. The second one is a very simple way of relighting things, and it's based on the average of the original and the relit picture. The third one and the fourth one are a bit more complex, and that's the reason why there's so many nodes over here. What we are doing for the third and the fourth one is we are taking all of these remapped images and we are averaging them out alongside other images. In the third output, we are averaging all of these remapped images with the original image, and in the fourth, we are taking that average and averaging it out again with the relit picture. Now, same as with the product relighting workflow, there is no definite best group. You have all four of them, so you can choose which one you like the most. In some cases, the second one is going to work out best for you. In some others, the third or fourth one are going to work best. Also, I have asked for some outsiders' opinion on Reddit and other places, and there seems to be an overall consensus that the second group results are more liked, while I personally like more the results from the third and the fourth group. So, how does it all work? Well, first of all, this workflow starts with a bypass node. And why is that? That's just to show you that this workflow can be copy-paste into any other workflow that you have. This is just for relighting, but you can use any other workflow before this if you need to. Then here we get our original image that we want to relight, and we have some models and prompt fields here. Now remember, this workflow is using IC light, so it's usable only with 1.5 models, no sdxl. I know this might be a deal breaker for some of you, but there's really no need to worry about optimal resolutions, because the way that IC light works, it doesn't need optimal resolution. It can work at higher resolutions as well than the usual 1.5 resolutions. So give it a try, even if you are an SDXL fan. Then we have our IC light core groups. Here you can find a light mask group where you can either draw a mask yourself or import your own light mask. Now, in the first case, if you're drawing it yourself, the workflow is not fully automatic. The first time you hit Q prompt, you're going to get an error because you don't have a light mask. So you're going to have to draw that in order to continue. While if you're importing a custom light mask, it's fully automated. Then there's our IC light group that we all know and love. And the way I like using it is by lowering the CFG a lot, let's say between 1.1 and 1.5. And that's because this way I don't get a very different resulting image. And then we have an optional control net group in case you need it. Now it's set to depth, but you can use any control net by changing the model and the preprocessor. Then we have our relit image that we don't like because it doesn't have the same colors as our original image. Continuing towards the right, we have our you can ignore this group. The you can ignore this group is made up of four different groups. In the first one, we have a frequency separation group, where we handle frequency separation for the original and the relit image. We're gonna get a high frequency layer and a low frequency layer for both images. The high frequency layer is gonna hold all the details, while the low frequency layer is gonna take care of light and color. Now, these are my first set of custom nodes, and you can find them on GitHub in the description below or on the manager. Then we have a remap range group. This group is here because one thing I've noticed is that when you are color matching two images, usually you get really blown out highlights and shadows. So this group handles all of that by remapping the histogram range, in the first case from 0 to 1, so nothing changes. In the second case, from minus 0.2 to 0.8. In the third case, from minus 0.4 to plus 0.6. And in the fourth case, you guessed it, from minus 0.6 to plus 0.4. Then we have a color match by range group, and this group takes care of color matching all of the resulting remapped images. By color matching them individually, I find that we get a better tone range overall when you are averaging them out. And finally, we have a frequency combined by range group. This group combines all of the resulting low frequency layers, which are remapped and then color matched, with the high frequency layer from the original image. And these are the resulting images. Now, some of them are obviously completely blown out in the highlights, and some of them are very, very dark, but they retain all of those highlights details that we would lose otherwise. Then finally, we have our results groups. Now, these four groups, as I was saying earlier, showcase four different options that you can pick from, and they use four different methods of color matching. The first group is the worst one by far, and what it's doing is just a simple color matching of the two low frequency layers from the original and the relit image, and then combining them together with the high frequency layer from the original image. And as you can see, in these cases we can get some very blown out highlights and the color matching is not great. Then we have our second option, the color match by average, original and relit option. What this group does is it's using a batch average node that averages out the low frequency layers from the original and the relit image. After that, it goes through to image blending mode nodes for color and hue preservation. Sometimes you will have to tinker around with them because not all combinations of original pictures and relit pictures need the same value in blending the hue and color, but overall it works great out of the box. Then we have our two more complex groups. Here we have the third group, which is a color match by batch average, remapped relit plus original group. What this group does, it's taking all of the remapped low frequency layers as well as the original low frequency layer, and it's averaging them all out. Here we have the same color and hue blending mode nodes, as well as a remap range node, and you can tinker around with the values in order to get better colors and range. For example, if the resulting picture here is too dark, you can up the minimum value, and there you go, we get less pronounced shadows. Then there's the last color matching group. Now, this was kind of hard to describe in the title. As you can see, there's a function here for x equals average of remap plus original, result equals average x plus original plus relit. But basically what it's doing, it's taking that average from the third group and it's using that to average out the relit image. So this is the closest to the relit image and the farthest from the original image in terms of lighting. Once again, here you have your color and hue nodes as well as a remap image range. Now, a lot of the testers seems to like the second group more than the others, but I personally like the third and the fourth the best. It's just that most of the times the resulting pictures come out too dark. But that's nothing that can't be fixed with some remapping or some post-production, I think. At least as a photographer, I feel like the third and the fourth one are the closest to what the relighting is actually doing. The last group we have here on the right is an optional Face ID pass. Now, this group was an idea by Reddit user SpacePixel, who helped a lot with reviewing my work and developing some custom nodes that could help me out and help others out like me. In this workflow, we are using their color matching and averaging nodes, and without these implementations, we wouldn't be getting here. So thanks a lot, SpacePixel. I absolutely love that you were willing to go the distance and give me some feedback on this. This group uses the original picture as a Face ID reference for regenerating any possible details that we have lost on the face while relighting, preserving details, and color matching. Now, I don't like this a lot because I think that even at lower denoise values, here we have a denoise set at 0.15, we'll still get too much of a difference between the final picture and the original picture. That being said, it's a very, very tiny difference, so it all depends on your personal preferences. Now, let's see some more example of how this works, and then let's talk limitations. So the first thing of note, as you can see here, is that if you run the workflow without understanding that you need a mask, you're gonna get this error. In my case, I am painting my own masks here in the preview bridge node, so I am getting this error because the first time I run it, I have no light mask. Let's paint one and hit Q prompt again. And as you can see, we now have a mask here that is being used for relighting purposes, and we don't get that error anymore. And this is a test for darker skin tones. And as you can see, the results are quite good. The second group is averaging things out way too much for me, while the third and the fourth group retain the actual relighting that we're doing a lot better. Now, one thing that I forgot to say is that right now the optional Face ID pass is set on the second group, but what you can do is just bring it down over here, and you can just replace the VAE encode pixels input with, let's say, the third group resulting picture, and you are good to go for using it with the third group, for example. I didn't want to put four different ones here, so as not to clutter the workflow too much. Now let's do another test with a very brightly and harshly lit original picture, and let's see where that goes. I'm going to paint a relight mask over here, and I'm gonna hit Q prompt. Now, as you can see here, since the original picture had some really blown out highlights and colors, we are getting some weird results in the second, third, and fourth group. And that's because the color and hue nodes are not set for these extreme cases. In this case, for example, you might want to go all the way down to, let's say, 0.1 in both of them and hit Q prompt again and see what happens. And that's already much better. You can bypass them entirely at times. Like in this case, where I'm bypassing them in the third group, and the result is much better, even if it's a bit too gray for my tastes. In order to fix that, we could just use some remapping to fix that. This workflow works well with full body pictures as well, but as you can start to see here, the less resolution you have for actual details, such as in the face or on the body, the more the high frequency layer starts having troubles with preserving details. But overall, it's a very nice result. So now let's show some of the limitations with just one example that will take care of all of the limitations at the same time. Here we asked for a very different kind of lighting, in the sense that it's both very, very harsh and direct, and that it's a very different color. You can guess it, we asked for a blue neon light. In these cases, the issues are that we are working with 8-bit images, and there's limitations to what we can actually do to achieve color matching with two wildly different histograms, at least before destroying our images completely. And also, there's only so much color matching you can do before you're losing out completely on the actual relighting you're trying to achieve when you're using colored lights. If we take a look at our relit picture, basically none of the results are what we would like to achieve while relighting it, because there's simply no way of color matching that with our original picture. They're two completely different pictures. And if we zoom in on the results, we can see that basically all of them are having troubles with making sense of what we are asking of them without resulting in some very bad JPEG quality. But well, apart from these very specific corner cases, this workflow can take care of color matching most of the pictures that I have tested. Now, obviously, I cannot be expected to test for every single situation out there, so I would love for you to try out this workflow and report back any feedback you might have so that I can expand on this and keep working on it. So overall, I think this is finally it. We managed to color match stuff inside of comfyUI while preserving details, while relighting all of that. I still think that it's a lot easier to do that in Photoshop, but since you all wanted an all-in-one workflow, we finally have it. Once again, shout out to Reddit user SpacePixel and to all of you who have tested alongside me these past few days. And also, I know I never say it because I don't like promoting my Ko-fi, but thank you all to those of you who have supported me on Ko-fi. It's never expected, but always appreciated. So thank you all for tuning in. If you like this video, leave a like and subscribe. And if you have questions about product relighting or how relighting works in general, you can check out my previous videos on the subject. My name is Andrea Baioni. You can find me on Instagram at risunobushi or on the web at andreabaioni.com. And same as always, I will be seeing you next week.